You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
I'm not Kira Mathers. How are you? My name's Allie LeBeau, and I work with Kira at the aquarium, and I'm going to be taking the lead for Kira today while she is off. She does have a couple messages for you guys, however. The first one is that Kira says, Happy Thanksgiving. She hopes that everyone has a good holiday, but there are also some work announcements as well. Kira will be, wanted to remind you guys that the research proposal is due November 13th at 11:55 p.m., and the final exam will be open December 3rd after the class and is worth 40 points. She wants to remind you, you can only take it once and it will have mostly content from the second half of the class, but there will be a few questions from the beginning as well. The week of the final will also have the normal weekly quiz and discussion board, so please plan accordingly for that. As always, if you have any questions for Kira, she is available even this week over email, so be sure to send those to her directly, and she's happy to help with anything that she can. So today, I am joined by another one of our colleagues at the Aquarium of the Pacific. I'm joined by Phil Conley, who's one of our education specialists. Hi, Phil. Thanks
Hi,
for joining
us
today. So today that we're going to have an opportunity to talk about a topic that a lot of people are interested in when it comes to marine science. We're going to talk about pollution, conservation, fisheries, and maybe get to some of those things that people can do themselves to help impact the ocean, because we've spent all this time talking about animals and these incredible environments, and so what can we do to help protect them? Before we go into much of the content, though, we have an opportunity to do one of our live from the aquarium. So we're gonna go directly to the Aquarium of the Pacific and visit with Erin, one of our educators at the aquarium. Erin, can you hear me?
I can hear you. How are you doing today?
We're doing great. So Erin, where are you at the aquarium right now?
I am right now up at our shorebirds exhibit. So I'll step out so you guys can get a better view of it. This is our shorebirds exhibit though. It's our typical wetland habitat.
All right, now where in the aquarium, if folks have been to the aquarium but are not sure exactly where that exhibit is, can you give them sort of where they might find it?
Yeah, definitely. So right now we are upstairs next to the stingray touch pool, so we're on the second level outside.
All right, so now it looks like there's a bunch of birds there at the exhibit, and it looks really beautiful, but why is it important that, why do we have an exhibit with a bunch of birds at the aquarium?
Yeah, definitely. So this area is your typical wetland habitat. So all the animals that you see in here can be found in our local wetlands, which are an area that are definitely very connected to the ocean. So regardless of the fact that these guys don't spend their entire lives underwater like, say, a fish does, they're still spending their entire lives really connected to the ocean and connected to that water.
All right, and now the aquarium shorebird exhibit is really interesting because a lot of those birds are rehab or rescue birds. Some of them have been born in captivity, but I think it's kind of neat that we have some rehab animals at the aquarium. Now, when you're looking at all those different kinds of birds, I know it's hard to tell them all apart, but what are some of the things that you can tell from the different beaks or the different feet? What can you tell us about those?
Yeah, definitely. So you can learn a lot about an animal just by looking at their basic biology. I'm pretty sure you guys can probably see this still up here. It's standing on that shallow area. Now, this still has really, really thin legs, and it uses those thin legs to be able to walk around in the water. You'll also notice it has that really long beak, and that beak is really perfect for digging around in the mud. It helps them to be able to grab their food items out of the sediment.
Excellent. All right. So now, if people wanted to go to a wetland, see it in their natural habitat, see some of these birds in their natural habitats, do we just have tons of wetlands here in Southern California that people could go to?
Yeah, we actually do have a bunch. There's some right here in Long Beach. Probably the most famous or popular around this area are those in Bolsa Chica. So right in the Bolsa Chica wetlands area, there's tons of these wetlands, lots to see. It's a really important area for the fish that live there, the birds that live there. And of course, the plant life is also very important.
Excellent. Yeah, now we definitely have some really beautiful wetland areas. I know that we're lucky to have some right near the aquarium. We sometimes take students over there, but we definitely don't have as much as we used to, right?
Yeah, and in fact, 95% of the existing wetlands in California are gone because of human development.
So what kind of impact does that have, not having those environments anymore?
Well, wetlands act as a big sponge. So they're basically soaking up everything that comes down, you know, the rivers and streams that flow. And we do get our occasional rains here in Southern California. And, you know, just like pouring water through a sponge, the water's going to go through and all the chunky stuff is going to get left behind.
Ooh, chunky stuff. Mm. Right.
That's right. Our wetlands here in California are also really important for migrating. It's a lot of times a stopover site for migrating birds that are coming through the area, even to help prevent coastal erosion. A lot of the plant life, well, the roots will kind of help to hold our coastlines in place so that we're not eroding our coastlines.
Excellent. Well, we can see that snowy egret right here. That's sort of the bird that I can see the best in this picture. I'd love to point that guy out because he's really recognizable. I think that he's probably the most well-known of all the birds in that exhibit. And he's sort of showing off for us right there. So, oh, look, he just put his head up. He heard me talking about him.
Yeah, definitely perfect timing. Oh, that looks like he took off. There you go. Can't see him anymore. That was our snowy egret, though, the big, beautiful white bird that we were just looking at.
Excellent. All right. Erin, do you have any last-minute things to add for us before we let you go?
I don't think so. Enjoy your class. Have a great day, and we'll see you later.
All right. Thank you so much, Erin.
Thanks, Erin.
All right, thank you to Erin and our team at the aquarium to go live. It looks like a beautiful day up there at Shorebirds. So today we're going to get started on the dirty topic of pollution. And of course, we started with the dirty topic.
Dirty.
We started with wetlands as a great example of an area that is really not only affected by human impact, but also is a biological place that is trying to act as a filter and as a sponge. So this is some pretty important stuff, and hopefully we'll have some good messages about positive things that we can do. So Phil, let's just get started with a big, broad topic. What is pollution? What do we talk about when we say that word?
Pollution. It's a really general term. Basically, pollution can be anything. It's an undesirable change, basically. So light, sound, plastics, oils, chemicals, physical things in the environment, all these things in the wrong place at the wrong time in the wrong amount can be pollution.
Oh, I think that's great. So wrong place, wrong time, wrong amount, right? Mm-hmm. So that's an important part of it as well. So the first kind of pollution that we're going to talk about is called point source pollution. And if we can get our first example of point source pollution image up here. Yeah, what do I mean by point source pollution, Phil?
I can point at it. Look, this ship right here is leaking oil. You can point at it. It is coming from a single point. Thank you, Allie, for the beautiful little red arrow there, illustrating that you can point at a point source pollution.
Okay, so we have another example of point source pollution. Let's see if we can get an idea. Here's another example. So again, this is a point source because we know exactly where it's coming from. Does that make it kind of easier to control, maybe?
Yeah, definitely. And in fact, most point source pollutions have been regulated in past years so that, you know, there are standards for how much these companies or factories can emit while they're producing the goods or the energy that we need mm-hmm. for our day-to-day lives.
All right, so we said that we were talking about solutions, but it sounds like point source pollution is a challenging one to start with solutions. So let's talk about the next one, which is non-point source pollution. So if point source pollution is coming from an identifiable source, non-point source pollution would be what?
It means that we just can't really identify exactly where it's coming from. So we might know, for example, that cars pollute, mm-hmm. but we can't go, your car is causing all the pollution in our neighborhood. We don't know how much people actually drive their car, and it's not measured or regulated. Another non-point source pollution is what you see behind us, which mm-hmm. is physical runoff. And this, you can see that, you know, it's really impossible to tell whose Sprite bottle that is right there washing down the drain and into our rivers.
So it sort of comes from the masses. It comes
right.
from all of us. So if we all did something, then potentially we'd be able to do something about it. So plastics, animal waste, pesticides, trash, anything that's coming out of your car. It's all coming from all of us, and we're all sort of playing a role in it. Okay, so it sounds like the biggest thing that we can really talk about with non-point source pollution is trash, right? So where are we going to see the trash?
Well, you're going to see it in the ocean, because all drains lead to the ocean. When we do get a rain, we don't have very many wetlands left. And so most of the outlets in Southern California look kind of like this. If you're looking in your neighborhood, this is what is left of your stream, your neighborhood stream. It's been channelized, and it all flows right down to the harbors and dumps straight out into there.
So this is different than when you flush the toilet, right?
Yes.
So tell me about that. What's the difference between a storm drain and a sewer?
Well, I think a lot of people grew up watching Ninja Turtles, and so they think that the sewers are actually the storm drains. And what these things are actually storm drains that handle runoff, extra rain that is not soaking into the ground. Mm-hmm. It's not permeating the soil. It's just hitting the street and running straight down. And instead of flooding people's yards or streets or things like that, it's going to be channeled straight out to the ocean. So
it's good that we have storm drains. Otherwise, right, it would be very difficult to drive on the streets. But if you've ever noticed after a rainstorm, it looks like somebody came along and cleaned your street. It's because everything went down that storm drain. So sometimes on the streets right by those storm drains, there are those little stencils right mm-hmm. there, right? So what are that's kind of telling people about this idea.
Yeah,
right? And I think
drains to the ocean is usually what it says.
Right, and we may even have a picture of that if we do. If not, you can probably go look in your own neighborhood. That's a good one.
Yeah. No dumping.
No dumping.
Drains to the ocean.
Next time you're walking down your street, take a look at those storm drains. Take a look right along the street and see if you see those stencils. That's been a really big effort. Okay, so we have a quick little video to sort of illustrate some of this, and this is going to be from one of the programs that we teach at the aquarium. This is the idea of us all being connected and our water being connected by the land. So if we can bring up that it all flows video. This is sort of illustrating the concept of a watershed. So this guy's walking down the street in No Bend Your Kneesville, and Phil, tell us what we're seeing here.
I think he threw some hot Cheeto wrappers on the ground there, and it went straight out into the ocean.
Terrible. So if he threw anything, his car was leaking, if he put a whole bunch of pesticides on his roses.
Yeah, now you're getting into another type of pollution that we have commonly that not a lot of people think of, but the chemicals that are in the products that we spray on our gardens or that we use in our automobiles, those things can end up in the water too. We just might not see them as much.
Oh, so the pollution we can't see, that's a great thing to point out. So this is a really beautiful illustration. This is a place that's very close to us at the aquarium. You can see...
Hey, that's my soccer ball.
Is your name on it? That's
no.
How we can point to who it belongs to.
I'm kidding. That's not my soccer ball.
So this is what it looks like in Long Beach after the rain. All that water goes down the storm drains, comes down the river, and meets us in Long Beach, and it brings all this trash with us. And as you said, we don't know that it's Phil's soccer ball. We don't know that it's my soda bottle. It kind of belongs to all of us. So it's kind of gross, huh?
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Well, let's talk about one of the biggest components of this non-point source pollution, and probably one of the gnarliest. Let's talk about plastics a little bit.
Mm.
So why are plastics bad?
Well, first of all, plastics are the most predominant source of pollution in the ocean.
Okay.
They're so bad because they're a man-made object. It's not like a natural object, like a piece of wood. You know, there's animals, bacteria in the environment that will break down that wood and decompose it quickly. There are some bacteria that will break down plastic, but it breaks down much slower and takes years, maybe even centuries, to biodegrade. So it's going to hang around in the environment. It's going to break into smaller pieces, so it's harder and harder as it breaks down to actually get it and clean it up.
And most of that trash is almost 90% of floating debris.
Right.
Is plastics.
Instead of sinking down to the bottom, it hangs out at the surface where most of the animals in the ocean live. So that's another threat that plastics pose for us.
So besides just hanging out for a really long time, what kind of animals are affected by this plastic floating in the ocean?
Basically anything that can get entangled in it, entrapped. Mm-hmm. We have fishing lines. A lot of people don't think about fishermen dropping their lines or places like that. everybody knows about the six pack of plastic rings that goes around the top of your soda.
That's kind of, everybody cuts those, right? Isn't
that
something that everybody does now?
I don't know. I gave up on that. I'm tossing them out the car window.
That's kidding. Great.
No, but yeah, entanglement is a big issue, but also animals eating. Anything like birds are especially attracted to brightly colored objects, and most of our plastics, unfortunately, are brightly colored in the packaging. They're attractive to us, and that means they're attractive to other animals.
So are plastic bottles and things that are already made and created, are those the only plastics that are floating out there? Or are there other things out there that we need to worry about?
Yeah, I think you're talking about nurdles.
I am talking about nurdles. Tell me about nurdles.
I love saying the word nurdles. Don't you love nurdles?
I do. It rhymes with turtle and doesn't belong in the ocean.
Right. And here's a palm full of nurdles that you're looking at right here. There are little plastic disc-shaped beads almost that... companies, anything that makes plastic items, toys, pieces of clothing, parts to your computer, it's all coming from this base plastic mold that they use to inject into molds when they melt it down, and that forms the plastic. It's one of the reasons that plastics are so useful and great, is we can pretty much form them into anything we want quickly. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, these accidentally get discharged into the environment, and you can see how small they are. They're tiny bits of what we call micro debris or micro trash.
So if they're so small and they're just floating around in the ocean, how do we know that they're there? How do we have an idea about how much is out there?
Well, we have a sampling method for very small things in the ocean. You guys probably remember learning about plankton in the ocean, and we also use plankton nets. And I think, Allie, you brought along a special object with
us. I sure did. Let's get our samples up. Thanks.
And this is a sample from, I think it's Algalita Research Collective, and they are interested in looking at plastic in the ocean. And we put some right out here on the desk to look at. Now, what happened was we dragged not us, but Algalita Research Collective, they dragged a plankton net, which is normally used for catching small animals, microscopic animals sometimes, in a big, thin mesh net. And what happens is it drags along the surface of the water and it catches anything, pretty much, that's bigger than the size of the mesh. And so here are a couple jars of plastic nurdles. This just came from the ocean. You can see there's a few insects in there as well. I don't know how those got in there, but
So this looks like a whole bunch of, and we were commenting that tan plastic doesn't seem to be very common, but there you have some tan nurdles, which would be converted into plastic bags, maybe.
Probably, or
root beer bottles,
melted down.
Maybe
the dye gets put in later. I'm not a plastic industry manufacturer, but yeah, these are plastic nurdles, and we don't even know how many out there in the ocean right now.
And Algalita does some really great work and is really trying to characterize not only what that trash looks like, but the impact that it's having on birds specifically. And we're finding these, and as Phil said, they take so long to decompose and potentially don't ever decompose. So they really do sort of give us a history of the impact on birds. Are these being eaten by animals? Are they filling up the stomachs? There's lots of really cool research about basically the insides of birds that have died because of the plastics that they've tried to ingest, which is kind of
And gross. Unfortunately, it just fills up their stomach and they end up dying of starvation, not because of the plastic itself actually killed them, but it just blocks up their system.
Well, now, one interesting thing that does happen with, and I'm going to take these back real quick. Interesting thing about plastic in the ocean is that it kind of piles together, right?
Yeah.
And we have an idea about where to go looking for it, right? It's maybe not totally evenly distributed. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Right. You're talking about gyres, which are the natural ocean currents in the oceans. All oceans have gyres. They are run by the temperature differences. So deep currents, cold currents, go down and travel from the North Pole towards the equator in the northern Pacific, and the warm currents travel up from the equator north towards the North Pole, and this creates a kind of a cyclone effect. So basically, like swirling your hand in the bathtub, we've all done it to mix the warm water in, and in the middle, that little bit of whatever is floating in, you washed off your you were covered in, I don't know, cookie dough or something innocent there that you were covered in. But it all swirls into the middle, and that's the idea that a gyre, we know where to look for the plastics because they all kind of swirl to the middle.
And we have an image that I'd love to share to sort of illustrate this idea of the garbage patch. The Pacific Ocean is the largest basin on the planet, and because, as Phil said, of this predictable movement of the currents, we have this huge patch that is now lovingly known as the North Pacific Gyre Garbage Patch. So there's some debate about how big it is. There's some debate about how concentrated it is, but there is a lot of discussion about this enormous pile of garbage. So then somebody asked me once, if we know exactly where it is, can't we just go scoop it all out?
Well, that's right? Hard because seasons change, mm-hmm. and the currents change with the seasons. The plastic moves with the currents. We don't know exactly where it is because you can't see it. Most of this plastic isn't big chunks of plastic just sitting on the top. It's that microplastic, and it's floating kind of in the first couple meters of the surface mm-hmm. of the ocean. So it's really hard to determine exactly where that plastic is.
So if we can't just go scoop it all out, what can we do?
I think you could probably not put it there in the first place.
Oh, that's a great idea. Let's talk about that. Let's talk about some things that we can do, at least to try to decrease the amount of plastics that are going into the ocean. I know that some cities, I live in Long Beach, mm-hmm. and Long Beach has recently had passed a plastic bag ban, which I think is really interesting.
It's so
right?
annoying. I forget my plastic bags all the time. And
oh, and you just have to carry it in your arm, right?
That's what I end up doing, either that or buying the paper bags.
So why does a plastic bag ban, and I have had somebody say, what am I supposed to do when I pick up my dog stuff, you know, because mm-hmm. I think we actually forgot to, oh, that's coming up soon. What's the benefit of a plastic bag ban? Why is that so good?
Plastic bags are a hard item because they're so lightweight and they do blow away so easily. I'm sure we've all lost one in the breeze as it ripped apart mm-hmm. and your groceries fell everywhere and it flew off to go join the rest of its friends in the garbage patch. Plastic bags are bad because they're not degradable. They sit at the surface. Plus, when they get in the water, they actually look like animals. So
it can be very bad for animals.
Turtles especially mm-hmm. think that they look like jellies.
So aside from plastic bags, how about those biodegradable plastics? At the aquarium, we have some really unique plastics. If you were to go upstairs to our Cafe Scuba, tell me a little bit about these guys.
These are more natural-based products. They're either made from corn starches or other things like that that will break down. Some of them are what we call photodegradable, which means that when sunlight hits them, the plastics in them start to break apart and degrade. And so these are much better options. You'll see them in a lot of places where organizations are environmentally conscious about the types and disposable utensils that you're using.
Yeah, so being thoughtful about what plastics you're using, what plastics you're purchasing, all those reusable water bottles, reusable bags, they actually do make a difference. They're important, huh?
Absolutely.
All right. Well, good. So we're going to keep using those. The other thing that I want to talk about is not just plastics in the water, but let's talk about a very stinky topic. Yeah, let's talk about animal waste. So we saw the guy throwing this trash. Mm-hmm. But there are other things that are non-point source pollution. Tell me about animal waste. How can animal waste be pollution?
Well, first of all, it's a nuisance. It's really annoying. It smells bad. If you're walking down your street and you step out of your car in the wrong place, we've all run into this here. And Allie, fortunately, didn't bring an example of this with her today, which I thank you for not bringing
that. Yeah, you're welcome. So if this is on the street and then it rains, well, that's good, right? It washes it away. It's not a nuisance anymore.
Yeah.
What happens when it gets into the ocean?
Unfortunately, it does start breaking down. And the reason that this one is a particularly bad pollutant is because it carries some harmful bacteria with it. So E. coli bacteria, which can make you very, very sick, ends up being in high concentrations at places where the water dumps out.
So if it's just rained and there's potentially this on the streets because people haven't picked up after themselves, what's a good rule about going into the ocean? Should you go right in or wait a little bit?
3 days. 3 days is what's recommended.
And why 3 days? Why do we have to wait?
Well, it helps things dilute, so things are moving around and moving away. It also helps it to degrade more, and the natural, you know, bacteria in the ocean to take back over once those harmful bacteria are done digesting the waste.
All right, so picking up after your dog is just a simple way of keeping the ocean and ourselves a little bit healthier. I like that. Let's talk about another chemical source of pollution, and that's pesticides. Pesticide that made the news a lot a few years ago is DDT, and it was a huge impact. It was used on land, but it had an impact on the ocean. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Right. This was sprayed in huge amounts, mostly in commercial agriculture. So when you go to the grocery store and you're picking out your vegetables, and they're nice and they look pretty, and there's no little gnawed on bits where they've been chewed up, it's because of a sprayer. Like, this is driven through the fields and sprayed some sort of chemical on them, and that has kept the bugs away. And one of the chemicals, DDT, which is dichlorodiphenyl trichloroethane, is particularly harmful because it bioaccumulates. So these small little bits that wash down each day from farms and things like that end up accumulating in the animals. As they eat other animals, it accumulates in them. And we were finding that birds, especially pelicans and eagles and larger birds like that, their shells would become very brittle because of this chemical. And so when the parents would sit on the nest to warm the eggs, they would end up crushing the egg of their offspring. And so this really caused a steep decline in some of the larger bird populations.
And now, is there still DDT in the birds? Is there still DDT in the water? Because I feel like I've heard that there was a ban now on DDT.
Right. There is a ban, so it's not currently being used anymore, or if it is, it's being used in very small amounts with permits. But it creates a sediment. Basically, it sinks down to the bottom, and then all of the microorganisms that live there are absorbing this. So there's places, certain places like off the Palos Verdes Peninsula, where there are huge amounts of DDT still in the system. These fish are really toxic, even to humans. So they recommend, if you're going to the beach and you're going fishing, look for the signs, make sure you know where you're fishing, and make sure that none of those areas are places that have been contaminated.
And there were some cool efforts to help rejuvenate those bird populations. I know on Catalina they had an effort to work on the eagle populations, and they brought in dummy eggs and then took the eggs out.
Right.
And those have been successful, right?
Yeah, and those have been very successful. The just kind of setting aside marine protected areas as well is showing to have some signs of improvement on those populations as well. And yeah, we're actually seeing a big comeback. Brown pelicans have been removed from
that's
the
right.
endangered species list, so they're threatened
and
status.
And they were very affected by DDT, so that's
off,
a great
yes.
success story.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so now with these nutrients running off onto the ocean, I think that our big message is that we are all connected to the ocean, even if we don't live right next to it, our actions are connecting us to the ocean. So our DDT runoff, our animal waste, our plastic runoff, that's all connecting us. But nutrients running into the ocean, you might think, well, nutrients, like pesticides, okay, that I can see that as a negative. But what about like fertilizers? Isn't that a good thing? Aren't we just fertilizing the plants in the ocean?
Right. Nutrients and fertilizers are good things. Unfortunately, like we said before, anything in the wrong place, in the wrong amount, at the wrong time, can be a pollutant. So all these nutrients and fertilizers, when they come down in a big rush all at once, they do fertilize the plants, but they fertilize them too well. And so we have this big growth of algae. You'll see the ocean turns kind of this either bright green or bright brown color, and depending on the type of algae that's growing. And when those algae die, when the nutrients run out, they all fall down to the bottom. And that's where what we call eutrophication happens. And eutrophication is when, you know, that algae starts to decompose and the bacteria pull all the oxygen out. These bacteria doing cellular respiration. And so they are pulling out all of the oxygen from the system. And areas like this, if they're small enough, fish can escape from them by swimming away. But big places like in the Gulf of Mexico each year, we have giant patches of low oxygen zones. and it just causes huge fish kills.
So there are certain areas that might be more susceptible to eutrophication, or areas that are kind of going or experiencing eutrophication a little bit faster. You mentioned the Gulf, and I think we have an illustration of this, an image to accompany this idea. Because it's at the mouth of the Mississippi River, mm-hmm. we can anticipate that there are going to be these areas, and again, these reds are going to have, the red is going to be lower dissolved oxygen, and that's because that dissolved oxygen, that oxygen, I mean, has been eaten up by the decomposing.
Right, and just to put this in perspective, that little scale there is in parts per million or milligrams per liter. Right there, if you're looking at about 3 to 4, that's pretty much as low as fish can go before they start really having some serious challenges with breathing and, you know, reproducing and their eggs being able to hatch out. And so you can see there are quite a few areas that are totally way below that. And those are huge areas where, you know, no fish are going to be able to reproduce.
The Gulf is such an interesting area. You know, it's right at the mouth of the Mississippi River. There's some really interesting movement, but maybe not always movement inside of there. Of course, a couple years ago, that's where the oil spill was. So lots of really interesting changes in the Gulf that I think we're still sort of figuring out how those all fit together. Okay, so basically what we do on our land is going to run off and affect the ocean, not always in these great ways. So let's talk about another reason that we need the ocean, and that's for fishing.
Fishing,
right?
Yeah.
So why do we fish?
Why do we fish? Well, we like fish.
I think it's fun.
It is fun. Recreation, there's one reason. Why else? Besides recreation, there's people that do it for real. I call them real fishermen.
Real fishermen, not just me sitting on the boat.
Yeah, not you. You're not a real fisherman. Even if you're really good at it, you're still not a real fisherman in my eyes. And these are commercial fishermen. So these are the fishermen who are going out catching fish and bringing them in to be sold in restaurants or at grocery stores.
And so those guys are part of fisheries.
Fisheries,
right?
Yes.
So when we talk about fishing, that word fisheries kind of gets thrown around. And,
yeah.
And how is that different than me sitting on my boat just fishing?
Well, because they have so much fish, it smells really fishery.
Ah.
Well, no. A fishery is anything that, any organized attempt to catch marine life. Real simple definition. So it's the boats, it's the captains, it's the companies, it's the type of animal that's being fished for. It could be anything. It could be squid, it could be fish, it could be clams.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. So fisheries aren't just fish, right? It's any collected effort. So I think we have a couple pictures actually of some fisheries. And of course, this is sort of what people may think of when they think of fisheries, right? Catching a lot of one kind of fish. Mm-hmm. But as Phil said, a fishery can also be for invertebrates or any other animals. So we have another fishery here. This is a really interesting one. So we have basically a effort to gather a certain kind of food for selling. Mm-hmm. And people are going to be feeding themselves.
Right.
Potentially feeding animals, potentially feeding other fish.
Yeah, about a third of fish that we take out of the ocean goes into our pet's food. So if you look at your pet's food on the label on the back and it says fish meal byproduct, that's mm-hmm. just a big bunch of ground up fish parts that usually people don't want. So.
And there are a lot of people around the world, maybe the United States isn't the number one consumer of seafood, but around the world there are people who get their primary source of protein is fish.
Yeah,
right?
About a fifth of the world. One fifth. So one in five people rely on fish as their number one source of protein. Here in the United States, I think it's either beef or chicken, but most places in the developing world, it's fish.
It's fish. Okay, so now if we know the fish is good for us, it's got the omega-3 fatty mm-hmm. acids, it's a good thing for us, it's a good source of protein. Where do we go from there? Well, we can sit and
Let's eat fish all day.
Okay, so what do we need to know about fisheries?
Well, unfortunately, fisheries are in decline.
Okay, what does that mean?
It means that we are taking out more fish than are in the ocean reproducing. It's kind of like going to the bank and constantly taking out more money each day and never putting any money back in or letting that money grow. So our fisheries, when we say they're in decline or they're threatened to be in decline, means that the fishermen who are going out there are harvesting more fish at once than can reproduce in that period, same period of time.
So one of the reasons that fisheries are in decline and sort of the impact on our ocean is a term that a lot of people have heard of before. I know when I was growing up, dolphin safe tuna was a big deal. And this is the idea of bycatch. So Phil, let's talk about what is bycatch and why is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? What are we talking about?
Yeah, it's an unintentional bad thing.
Okay.
Bycatch, when the oceans were plentiful, it wasn't a big deal. You go out and you drag a big net through the ocean, you see what you get, you pull out the good things that people want to eat, and you're doing great. You take the rest of the fish that are on your deck and you just scoop them back in the ocean. If they live, they live. If they don't, oh well, you know what? Not a big deal. But
can't they just sell that stuff? I mean, if they caught it, can't they sell that other bycatch too?
A lot of places, there are fish that nobody wants to eat. It's tiny fish, it's crabs, it's other things that, you know, people don't normally eat. And bycatch can really be just anything that's unintentional.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a couple ways that bycatch happens. And one of them is those big nets that just catch everything. It's called a purse seine. And I think we're going to talk about that in a little bit. But
so maybe there are different ways that we can fish that might reduce or eliminate bycatch. So maybe it's not as simple as just saying one kind of fish is good and one fish isn't good, but it's getting into how that fish was caught.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, now I know that turtles, and like I said before, I remember dolphin safe tuna was a huge thing when I was growing up.
Mm-hmm.
What other kind of animals sort of get a lot of, you know, there are some big animals that are sort of sometimes bycatch as well, right?
Yeah. Sharks are a big one. So long lines are an issue. These are lines that go way out in the ocean. They've got hooks all along them, and they're just baited. Seabirds that are going out into the open ocean like albatross, and they're flying for long distances, and they see these fishermen out there. Suddenly, you know, there's a lot of food sitting at the surface, and it's easy to get because it's just floating there on a nice big long line for them. They come down, they also get the hook with that. But yeah, bycatch pretty much affects a lot of animals in the ocean. It is a huge problem that we're adjusting the way we fish based upon that.
And 27 million tons of fish a year discarded.
Yeah, I see that.
This is bycatch.
Yeah, that's incredible. I can't even.
I
wish I had 27 million of anything, because even if you sold it for a penny, that would be a lot of money.
A lot.
Yeah.
All right. So I know that a big reason for bycatch sometimes, as Phil said, are some of these fishing practices, and he mentioned a purse seine, and we'll talk about that in a couple minutes. But I want to also talk about trawling. Because I think a lot of the fish that we might eat live on the bottom.
Right.
So if the fish lives on the bottom, what happens when we try to catch it?
So trawlers are used mostly in the shrimp fishing industry. And the way that trawlers work is that they have a big net. It drags behind the boat, kind of like a big bucket shape, and it just kind of scrapes across the bottom of the ocean floor. Sometimes they put extra things like spare tires along the bottom to drag through and knock things off, and it's really a destructive practice. Fortunately, in the U.S., it's been limited quite a bit. There's something called, here we've got a picture of a trawl net. So the top is floated by buoys, the bottom is weighted down, and it drags along the floor, and they just drag that. They're not looking exactly for what's down there, but shrimp live along the bottom. We know that shrimp hang out, and those all get caught in the net. Unfortunately, everything else that's down there is also going to get caught in the net. So any sort of little rock outcroppings that a fish might be hiding in, small plants that their young ones might be living in, all of that is just getting dragged up indiscriminately into that net.
Now, this is a big deal when it's done, especially in coral reefs, I imagine.
Absolutely. So we always at the aquarium recommend U.S. caught fishery products, because the U.S. is kind of leading the way, even though, you know, we're still not the best at managing our fisheries. A lot of the fisheries in the United States are a lot better than other places. So if you get shrimp from, you know, Southeast Asia, for example, that's been shipped over here, not only is there an issue that you're shipping it across the ocean in order to eat it, which is a little crazy when we've got shrimp right here, but also just the methods and the habitats that it's done in. So when you drag that across a coral reef, something that could have taken 200 years to grow is suddenly just wiped out in an instant.
So this sort of leads us to this next concept of overfishing. So not only are we catching too much of what we don't want, we're kind of just catching too much of what we do want too. So when we say overfishing, this is a really great image, I think, to sort of illustrate. And the analogy that you used earlier about a bank account, we're not giving fish an opportunity to replenish themselves. So what are we doing with this overfishing?
A lot of it's ending up as waste. So we're not eating all of the fish that we bring in. Some of it is bycatch that we're just tossing back out. But some of it is just kind of fishing the same kind of fish. People get stuck on one thing, like tuna, for example, and we really like tuna. So we're going to go out and we're going to find as many tuna as we can because that's going to make us as much money as we can. Who cares if there aren't any tuna left tomorrow because I made my money today?
Well, and you know, I grew up on the East Coast, and such a huge part of the history and the growth of that area was around cod fishing. And cod fishing is not such a huge part anymore. I mean, it is really such an illustrated, such a great example of of a change in the industry and just really overfished to such a point. We do want to mention Chilean sea bass, because Chilean sea bass does get a lot of press, and it's one of those fish that sometimes lots of different fish are actually called Chilean sea bass sometimes because it has a response. There is a demand for it in the market, and so sometimes you'll get a number of different species that are called Chilean sea bass in a restaurant and aren't necessarily the exact same species. So worldwide, up to 90% of all large predatory fish, such as sharks, orange roofie, red snapper, Chilean sea bass, have been depleted.
Yeah, and there's no such thing as orange roofie either. It's something like a slime fish is its real name. But
same thing with orange roofie, right? Yeah. There's so many different fish that are going to show up on your plate, but on your menu.
Yep, and that means that about 10% of the fish stocks worldwide are left, is what we're estimating. Some estimates predicted by 2048, which is not too far off for some of us, and it's going to be a completely outfish. Like, we're going to overfish the entire ocean, is what they're predicting. So the U.S. has started taking some steps. Congress has passed some laws saying that we have to put out a warning when these fish stocks start to look like they're going to become overfished, which means, you know, we're starting to get to the point where we're taking more than we're letting to reproduce. And they're going to say, you know, we're going to put a stop on that certain type of fish. You can't fish for that anymore. And you're going to give it at least 10 years to recover.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, what about farms? There's lots of talk about farming for fish.
Yeah.
And sort of it's like aquaculture instead of agriculture. Is that a potential solution for us?
Yeah, farming fish has been a great solution. In the meantime, while our fish stocks have been declining, farming for fish, if it's done the right way, can be really great. Unfortunately, a lot of people, again, like to take the shortcut way and put all kinds of stuff into those fish places where, you know, all they've got the pit fish in the big pen. And they're just kind of dumping anything that the fish will eat into there. And that creates a lot of pollution, first off, just whatever they're dumping in there, but also keeping the fish in such high concentration kind of devastates the area around it. All those fish, as they're eating, they're producing waste. And that waste goes out in the water and poisons anything else that might be living there.
There's also the challenge of where these farms are put. So if farms are put in a place, but that's not their natural habitat, and then potentially you're introducing invasive species because there are some that are going to escape.
Some of them are definitely going to escape. And another issue is you're introducing disease, because when you have, usually in these farms, it's what we call a monoculture. So basically all the fish respond from the same kind of little small group of breeding stock, and they're pretty much biologically identical. They're a whole bunch of twins, brothers and sisters, so when one of them gets sick, mm-hmm. all of them get sick because none of them are resistant to the diseases, and that passes that disease, it allows it to spread and passes it out into the natural fish stocks as well.
All right, well, so now that we've ended on this lovely doom and gloom point, wow, I think that important to know sort of the state that we're in, but it's important to know that there are options for the future, and we're going to talk a little bit more about those when we come back. So we're going to take a quick couple minute break, and we'll be back in just a few minutes to talk about some more fishing methods and some opportunities to for the future. So join us.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We're passing out information for all the parents that come in, so we're letting them know where the workshops are, what time, and what to find inside the gym.
I'm Carla Carlini, President and General Manager here at LA36. I'd like to take a moment to thank you for watching our channel and to tell you some important information that will be affecting some Time Warner customers in the city of Los Angeles. Beginning October 8th, if you do not have a cable box, digital adapter, or cable card, you will not be able to see LA36 and some other channels like this one. You'll need to contact Time Warner to get a free digital adapter. Here's how. You can call 855-286-1736 or go online to twc.com/digital adapter. It's that easy to continue seeing the programming you love, Los Angeles. From the stunning performances at the Ford Theater to the thought-provoking speakers at the Los Angeles World Affairs Council to the revealing political discussions from LMU and all the educational programming from our partners at schools like Cal State Dominguez Hills and USC. So contact Time Warner today for your free digital adapter. You won't want to miss 1 minute of LA36, your connection to your community. Thank you for your support. We appreciate you watching.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Thank you.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, welcome back to Bio 190. My name's Allie LeBeau, and I'm joined by Phil Conley, and we're filling in for Kira, who is not here today. So today we're talking about pollution and fisheries and some conservation efforts, and I know a lot of you guys are excited about the mystery item. Kira told me to do it after the break, so sorry to make you wait. So our mystery item today is this guy right here, and he is connected to our discussion of fisheries, even though I'll give you a hint, he's not a fish.
It might be hard to see on the screen there some of the colors, but this is iridescent, so it's kind of rainbow colored on the inside. It's kind of bowl shaped, and then it's got these interesting little holes running all the way back, and then these ones look like they used to be holes, but they are closed up.
So send in your guesses. Let us know what you think the mystery item is. And while we're waiting for you guys to let us know what you think the mystery item is, we're going to talk a little bit more about fisheries. Now, we were talking about, Phil, you were using a really great analogy about a bank account, not letting the stocks build back up, right? Taking it all out and over withdrawing. And so we had an opportunity to do a little demonstration on some fish and how they're gonna help the fish stocks grow back up. So what do we have here, Phil?
We have some little friends that we brought with us. So this is my first little friend right here. We'll put it on the camera here.
Okay. So if we could have that overhead camera, we're gonna take a look. What kind of fish is this?
This,
or what is this supposed to be?
This looks like a rockfish to me.
Okay.
And yeah. This little rockfish here says, I can have 150,000 offspring.
Now, does he really have 150,000 offspring? Does he really have that many babies survive and grow to adults?
No. Oh. We're talking about kind of the biological potential to have 150,000. So what this is saying is that a fish this size could, in its lifetime, have 150,000 offspring, potentially. If they all survived, if it laid that many eggs, it would lay 150,000 offspring. So that's not a very big fish. It's kind of a...
About a foot.
About a foot long.
Okay. So 150,000 offspring. Now, if all of those 150,000 offspring survived, we would definitely not be having this conversation about fisheries.
So they lay tons of eggs. Like, this is just kind of a visual representation here. And we can show you that this string, each of these little tiny fish-shaped fish represents 10,000 fish. So there's 15 on there, which equals 150,000 offspring. That's for this fish right here.
And so if he has one, which is sort of normal, if we could even increase that to two or three offspring surviving in the next generation, we would have an increase in fish stock. Okay,
yes.
So then the next guy we have is this one right here, and we can hold it up just real quickly in comparison. So this one is a little bit older.
Yeah, probably say, I don't know, what, a little 20% bigger maybe?
And then this guy's about 13 years old, and so let's show an illustration here of how many he can have.
Wow.
700,000. So as they get older, as they get bigger, they get much better at having babies.
That's right.
Okay, so this is a term that is often used. It's called fat old female fish.
Yeah.
The bigger they get, the older they get, the better they are at having babies. So at 13 years old, he's about 20 inches. About 700,000 potential offspring.
Right, and then just a little bit older, we've got one more here. I'll hold it up next to the other one. So this is your big mama jama here. And this one claims to be able to have 1,700,000 offspring. And that is for a fish, quite a lot. So we're stretching out the string. We're going to have to put this up on the big screen between Allie and myself. So you can see
Whoa, we're decorating for Christmas.
Happy holidays. So this is quite a bit more, even more than twice the amount that the fish, just slightly smaller fish, could have, and definitely multiple times as many fish as the
So this is a great illustration of why it's important to have places for fish to get big and old and fat, because the older they are, the better they get. And let's see if we can do this here. Mm-hmm. The bigger and older they get, the much better that they're going to be at having babies. So we can try to do that overhead again, and I'll
double it up.
Double this one up a little bit. See how that one works. Yeah. So this is a really great demonstration, illustration that we like to use to show why it's important that there are those marine protected areas, these safe places for fish to get big and old and fat, because if they only get to be 7 years old, this is how many they might produce. And again, we're trying to get them from having one egg last to adulthood and go into be a full-grown adult. All the way to this, they're much more likely, if they can get that big, they're going to have that many more eggs, and they're going to be able to potentially pass on their genes to the next generation. They're going to be able to increase their fitness, which is really the goal of any organism.
Yeah, and marine protected areas for a while were very controversial. A lot of fishermen at first didn't like the idea of areas where they couldn't fish because, you know, fish stocks are declining. It's getting harder and harder for them to make a living. So for someone to come in and say, hey, you know, now you can't fish over here in this really nice area where there's lots of fish because we want them to have a place to themselves. Mm-hmm. But what they found was that by protecting these areas, they're actually increasing the amount of fish that were available. It looks like we have a phone call coming in for you, Allie.
All right. Hi, Crystal.
Hi, I have an answer to the question, or the extra credit question. Is it an abalone shell?
It is an abalone shell. Yay, Crystal, good job.
Yay.
So, all right, so Crystal, I'll make a note and be sure to pass that along to Kira, that you got the extra credit question. It is an abalone shell, and we're talking about abalones because they are an example of a fishery that was definitely overfished. So to go along with our abalone question, our abalone mystery item, we have an extra credit question that we'd like to pass along to you guys as well. And the extra credit question is, what is the biological term for an organism's ability to reproduce? And I will tell you that it's right along with what Phil and I have been talking about with all our little vermilion rockfish beads, and it's a really important component to understanding the abalone fisheries as well. So if you have that, go ahead and send that in to Kira through Blackboard, and she'll be monitoring that that extra credit question. So congratulations, Crystal. Good job. Sounds like it wasn't that hard, but it was a good...
It was a very good good guess.
Good connection.
Right.
All right, so marine protected areas. Thank you, Crystal, for chiming in on that one. So marine protected areas, the other thing that I think is so great about marine protected areas is that fishermen were included in that discussion, in the decision. There were lots of different stakeholders at the table, and what they're finding now, which of course they're gonna have to continue monitoring and figuring out how do we know if these are successful, the idea of marine protected areas is that there's some connectivity. So there's spillover, and the impact isn't just on that one area, but right around the areas as well.
Exactly. And there's nothing that stops a fisherman from pulling right up to, you know, a marine protected area and fishing there. It's perfectly legal as those fish migrate outwards towards that. And another thing that's really great about the marine protected areas is that, unlike some things that government decides to do, this one is backed up by scientific research. Mm-hmm. So part of the legislation was that each year there were going to be studies done so that if this wasn't actually being efficient at producing more fish, then they would be nixed, you know. They would be opened back up for people to use however they liked. Mm-hmm. And what we're finding is that through that research, we're really finding that they are effective, and it's really going to help with our fish stock situation.
And California Department of Fish and Wildlife has created some tools to help fishermen know where they are. There's some smartphone apps. There's some printed materials. They want to make sure they're working really hard with the fishing community to make sure that the information gets out there about where these areas are. How do I know I'm out in my boat? I just want to go fishing. They're putting it back on the fishermen to make sure that they're responsible for knowing and being accountable, but they're doing everything they can to make it as easy as possible to get that information. So this goes right into what we were talking about before with fishing practices. So when we talk about marine protected areas, we're not only talking about recreational fishermen, we are talking about the impact on commercial fishermen. And it's worth talking about some of these ways that commercial fishermen do their job. So we had mentioned before trawling, and we had the images of the trawl and described the impact on the bottom of the ocean. But let's go back to this idea about purse seines, because I think that there's a great illustration that we have to show, I guess this is a, we can do this one.
So this is the big bag method of grabbing fish. So fish, especially schooling fish, open ocean, or what we call pelagic fish, often school together for protection, and fishermen use this to their advantage. When they find fish schooling together, what they'll do is they will take out a big net, and basically it's a huge wall of netting, and it's got floats on the bottom, or floats on the top and weights on the bottom. And what happens is there's a line that kind of cinches that bottom in and makes it into a bag. And you can see going back on this image towards the top right corner, all of the fish in the bag there. So if you stretch across the top, keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going, out towards the top right corner, you can see all the way back, there are fish in this big bag. This whole thing is a big bag of fish, and you can see it's kind of scrunched together there.
I see, because it's still the bag right
here. So that's bag. And so that's all fish in there. And Allie, do you think this is a really sustainable way of catching fish?
I do not think so.
Yeah. What happens here is you take all the fish and there's none left to reproduce. Mm-hmm. So it's not what we call sustainable. You can't keep doing this forever.
I think that's just a really great illustration. And you know, purse seine always makes me think of the purse strings, and you're pulling the purse strings. So wanted to make sure that we really drove that point home. Another way, another method for fishing, Phil mentioned before, are long lines. And I'm not sure if we have we do have an illustration of long lines. So Phil, talk about some of the challenges of this. So we have the boat right here.
Okay. And so they're dropping this long line out there in the ocean, and then they're just kind of leaving it there. And they leave it there for several days, several weeks, and they come back to see what they've caught. Well, unfortunately, when you leave a bunch of food out, animals will come and animals will grab onto that line. Here's a turtle with a long line in its mouth, a shark. Here's some seabirds, and you know, anything that's out there that's going to be interested in checking out this food source is going to get hooked. And so one of the things that we've started doing with long lines is, instead of putting frozen bait on the lines, they'll put fresh bait on. And that causes it, you know, everybody knows ice floats in water, so frozen bait is not going to, or thawed bait is not going to float as close to the surface where birds are. Another good fishing method using long lines, a change, you know, not that long lines are great, but a change is that they put them out after dusk. Mm-hmm. So as the sun goes down, there's fewer animals out there hunting. These long lines catch the animals that they are looking for and prevent them. Also, it's now the law that all longline fishing boats have to have big cutters to reach down and cut these animals free before they pull the lines in. So they go out and they check, make sure nothing's snagged on there. If there is something, they can cut it. They've also changed the shape of the hook from, you know, your normal hook shape to a circle hook, kind of bent in on itself. And that prevents a lot of the larger animals like turtles and sharks from getting hooked on those.
I think we actually have a picture of that too, the J versus the circle hook. We can take a look at that, because it's not just, you know, it's interesting because when we talk about longline fishery, it's not just the birds on the top, but it's impacting above and below. Mm-hmm. So there are some preventative measures that are, yeah, this is a great image here. So we're looking at the different hooks, and this guy versus the J hook are going to be able to, well, tell us about this, Phil. Look, I just made like a little letter.
Well, the J hook is pretty much going to snag anything, and it's going to snag things that are just swimming by as well. So it causes a lot more entanglement issues. And so the J hook is not the one that they want. They want the one where This one is going to go into the fish's mouth, and that's when it's going to hook onto the animal and catch them.
So that that circle hook, they believe, is responsible for about 89% reduction in sea turtle bycatch.
That's wonderful. Which is great.
By just changing the hook. And this is a kind of adjustment or modification that isn't going to negatively impact the industry. It's not going to take away the opportunity to fish. You know, birds are often victims of long lines. So what are some of the ways that they've been trying to help on the surface? So this is below the surface.
Yeah, another way on the surface, besides just putting them out at night and putting out fresh bait so that it sinks, is they have big streamers that kind of wave through the air, kind of like the you know, car salesman, big dancing man like this. And it scares off the birds away from those areas and keeps them from flying into those things.
Okay. Well, so I want to make sure that we do talk about one modification that has been pretty successful. It's called a turtle exclusion device, or it's sometimes abbreviated TED, T-E-D. And, you know, turtles are one of those charismatic megafauna. Everybody loves turtles. Everybody loves dolphins. So anytime that we can protect them specifically, it's going to be a good thing. So can you explain how those TEDs work?
Yeah, the TED is basically a trap door. So we've got a little image of one right here. It's the little steel bars there. And so you've got your regular, you know, trawl net or whatever going down. And at some point along the top of the net, there's going to be one of these trap doors. And the regular fish that they're trying to catch, the shrimp and things like that, are going to be at the bottom of the net. They're going to be moving along the bottom, but a turtle is going to be trying to get out. So it's going to be actively swimming upwards towards the net, poking against this thing, trying to find a way to get past this barrier. And what the TED does is it provides them that easy out. They run into that, it lifts up, and the turtle can swim out without them losing the rest of their fish that they're fishing for. And they've been really, really also very successful. About 97% of all turtles that were shown to be caught in there, they showed that they could use the TED to get out.
And so this is now mandatory in U.S. waters, is
yes.
that right?
Right, okay. Which is one of the reasons why U.S. fisheries are a better choice when you go to the grocery store, you go to a restaurant, you want to know where your seafood came from, because a lot of other places aren't following these regulations.
And so when we say local, I know, you know, a lot of people say local and they assume it has to come from California, but when we say local, we really mean United States, right?
Right.
So we know where our seafood is coming from, and we know that if it's caught from U.S. waters, that we're assuming certain measures have been taken. You know, unfortunately, the fish are not going to know a boundary, a political boundary. They're going to know an environmental boundary. So we are only able to make certain adjustments to our own waters. So we can suggest that people make seafood choices based on where the fish is caught.
Yeah, and what's exciting about this device too is now it's in development for also a fish exclusion device. So not only turtles, but also fish might be able to escape from nets, ones that they're not trying to catch. So that'll be another big reduction in bycatch in these shrimp industries.
And you know what I think is great about the TED is that somebody had to invent it. It was a solution to a problem. Mm-hmm. And we always at the aquarium look to the students that walk in the door as the ones that are going to come up with ideas that we haven't thought of. And if it's as simple as coming up with, hey, a trap door, because the turtle's going to be heavier and the shrimp can't get out that way, but the turtle can. Somebody had to invent that. Somebody had to come up with that idea, test it, try it out, and now it's the standard. It's not the rule.
Definitely. Another thing that I wanted to bring up is another good fishing method is what you were talking about before yourself. When you go out and fishing, what do you use?
I use my fishing pole and my line, and that's it.
Okay. So we have some video.
And my spidey sense.
I think we have some video of Allie fishing for tuna here. If we could pull up that.
This is not me fishing, don't worry.
She's really good
I'm
at it.
I'm really good. Can we bring up that American tuna fishing? All right, so this is American Tuna is a company out of San Diego. And what we're seeing here is a fisherman on the back of a boat. And there is a pole for each fisherman. And they're able to fish and bring the fish right into the water, right into the boat. No opportunity for bycatch. Oh, yep, see, no bycatch. So obviously there are benefits to this, but is there any disadvantage to this type of fishing practice?
Yeah, it costs more. So you saw all those guys lined up along the back of the boat. It's very labor intensive. You have to pay someone to do that. You'd have to pay me to go out and stand in the cold water and get splashed and, you know, hoist these 50-pound fish out of the water all day long. And that's what we end up with. Instead of, you know, your 99-cent can of tuna that you might buy at the grocery store, suddenly your tuna costs a couple bucks. And, you know, you look at that and you go, oh, well, sustainably caught tuna, that's not in my budget this week. A $2 difference in the price of your tuna could be huge. Unfortunately, I'd rather pay $2 for my can of tuna and have tuna for the rest of my life because I love tuna, rather than pay 99 cents now and then by the time I'm 50 or so have no tuna left ever.
And it is good to point out that tuna is probably the most common pole and line caught species. So it is becoming more common that tuna is caught that way. But as Phil said, there's a challenge, there's an economic challenge. So what finding the balance is going to be that tricky spot. And I agree that maybe having tuna for the long run is more important than having tuna this week or every week. And so there are different options. Maybe we don't have tuna every week. Maybe we have tuna this week, and maybe we have albacore another week.
Right.
So very similar, and it's actually usually a more sustainable fishery, isn't it?
Absolutely, yeah. And choosing these companies is another important decision. When you choose these companies, it gives the companies an opportunity to really grow and expand, and that helps bring the cost down. So, you know, now it's no longer $2 for the can of tuna. Maybe it's down to $1.50, which is not so much of a difference from your regular dollar can of tuna. So what we choose to do at the aquarium is we support American Tuna by selling their products in our restaurants. So if you've ever been to the aquarium and you bought the tuna, you bought tuna from American Tuna Fisheries.
My friend just had a tuna sandwich this afternoon. It was delicious. We also sell the American Tuna in cans at our store. So we're really glad to support. Again, it's a local company. It's a sustainable practice, and potentially it's a little bit more expensive, but it's a choice that we're really excited to promote. So what are some other practices? Let's talk a little bit about trolling.
Trolling, not just for the internet. it's actually what the name trolling came from, is a fishing technique where you kind of just cruise slowly and you're tossing your bait out here and there, and you're trying to catch something. You're trying to get somebody to bite. So just like trolling on the internet where you're going on sites and you're tossing out comments here and there to make people upset. The same thing with the fish. You're going and you're moving very slowly. It is a very sustainable method of fishing. It's been the traditional method of fishing for hundreds of years, thousands of years even, since people have had boats. They've been trolling for fish. You swim, you know, motor your little boat around to where the fish are. There we go. And then you toss your line in where you see some fish, and hopefully you catch some. And so it's very, very sustainable. Also, if you accidentally catch something, I think we've all pulled in something fishing. If we're a fisherman, you've probably pulled in something you didn't want. It's very easy at that point. You're there to remove the whatever it is, the shark or anything from your line.
I think the other thing that, you know, we might want to mention is that there are uses of technology, right? So if we're trying, if a fishery is trying to curtail expenses, then potentially what they could do is, how can we be better about knowing where the fish are? So that's, they're in business. They want to catch as many fish for the least amount of money. So if we can support technologies and ways to help find the fish, and whether that's keeping up with changes in climate and changes where fish are, changing where fish populations can be found at certain times. You know, there can be lots of really great collaboration between scientists and fisheries so that they know where the fish are. It's cheaper for them to go, and then maybe there's more opportunity for them to invest in more expensive fishing practices because they've already taken out some of the time and the expense of just finding where the fish are.
Right, and the key there is kind of like the little Saturday morning cartoon on PBS, the more you know. So the more you know about where the fish are, the more we're gonna be able to figure out how to fish for them more effectively and more sustainably. And that basically boils down to doing research, big ocean-wide projects where we get lots of people out there in the ocean, places where you know, we haven't really discovered yet. And mm-hmm. so that's what's really great about this human-made problem is there's going to be a human-made solution for it.
I agree. So the more you know. So we want to have some great take-home messages, right? Because we don't want people to stop eating fish. We think it's a really good, important thing. People... I like fish. I like fish tacos. I like seafood, right? So how can we take, what are some good take-home messages that we can leave folks with to feel optimistic? What can we have them do?
Well, you can choose, like you said earlier, to buy locally. Number one thing is your pocketbook determines mm-hmm. where the industry is going to go. If you're not choosing these things that are bad for the environment, these companies aren't going to be out there fishing for mm-hmm. these things and, you know, causing a lot of bycatch or using bad practices. That was proven with dolphin-safe tuna in the 80s. People saw that dolphins were getting caught. People loved dolphins. They said, I'm not buying tuna if I know that it's been caught with dolphins and the dolphins have been killed in the nets. I'm not going to buy tuna anymore. And so what those companies did was say, you know, we're going to figure out a way to catch tuna without catching the dolphin.
And they responded to the demand, yep. Absolutely. We have a question real quick from Michaela. Michaela said, how does bioaccumulation affect humans? That is a great question. So earlier we were talking about DDT and how DDT made its way into the ocean and how it was really had a negative impact on birds, especially brown pelicans and eagles. So this is a great question, Michaela. Phil, do you want to start it off?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So bioaccumulation, the basic idea is that small fish are eating things that have these chemicals in them. So things like heavy metals, like mercury or DDT, build up. Mercury is one that you're really concerned about with humans because it's so toxic to us. Mm-hmm. So this fish is going around, let's say this fish eats 1,000 little fish. So these little tiny fish, and he's gobbling those up. That means this fish suddenly has 1,000 times as much mercury as each of those little fish had. Well, this fish now has 1,000 times, and Big Mama Jama here comes around and eats 1,000 of these fish. So yeah, 1,000 in its lifetime. So that means that now this Big Mama Jama fish has 1,000 times 1,000, which I don't even know, what is that, 10,000?
1,000 times 1,000 is 4 zeros, no, 3, 6 zeros, 10, a million.
A million, mm-hmm. a million, I'm terrible at math. Kids, learn your math. A million times, so you go to your restaurant, you put this fish down, and you go, I want a nice big tuna steak here. I'm going to cut this big side of the fish out. And you pull that out and you put it on your plate and you eat that. You've just eaten maybe a million times the amount of mercury that this little fish ate when it was consuming its food.
And I think that's a really great point, Mikhail, that I'm glad you brought up, that the bioaccumulation of any toxin in the environment is going to be more felt in the higher levels of the food chain. Mm-hmm. So we see that with domoic acid poisoning. We don't see copepods or fish being affected by it. We see the birds and the sea lions. We see the top predators in that food chain. And really, we have to look at ourselves as those top consumers in the food chain and understand that that buildup through the food chain is that biomagnification or bioaccumulation.
And this one is especially important for mothers as well. You'll see the warning signs mm-hmm. when you go into restaurants that eating too much fish can harm your fetus because basically you're dosing yourself with a bunch of heavy metals and you've got this tiny little thing that's growing inside of you and suddenly that is getting fed all of that stuff that you're eating.
And some of that is, you know, going to be some species specific. Mm-hmm. And so again, it's always good to get some information about that. There's lots of warnings when you fish from a pier. There's pier in Long Beach, pier in Santa Monica. There are piers everywhere in Southern California. And usually when you go and you are fishing off of those piers, they have warnings that'll say that they recommend that you don't eat any croaker that mm-hmm. you find right there because, again, just the level of toxins that are in those fish. So it's always good to get information, again, species-specific. Tuna is one that has been known to have higher levels versus albacore, white sea bass versus some other species. It's the challenge, I think, with this conversation about fisheries is that there's not a black and white answer. You know, there's not farms are always better than wild caught. That's not always true. It's not fish, all fish is bad, and you know, it's really difficult. So trying to find those right solutions. So at the aquarium, We have an initiative at the aquarium. It's called Seafood for the Future. And I'd love for you to tell our folks about Seafood for the Future, if you wouldn't mind.
Yeah, great. Seafood for the Future is an organization that basically monitors what's going on. They monitor the most current research in the field, and they are looking at which fish are currently being overfished, which fish are abundant, which fish are healthy, which fish are not so healthy maybe because of bioaccumulation or things like that. Mm-hmm. And they're providing recommendations, not only recommendations for which type of fish to eat, but also where to get that fish. So there's some sponsorship between the aquarium and local restaurants. Mm-hmm. And you know, you go to these restaurants and you'll see very clearly marked on their menus, which are really good sponsored mm-hmm. websites. So here's a website here.
This is the Seafood for the Future website. And you know, I think that one of the great things about this is it's if you go to the restaurant and you mm-hmm. ask the waiter, where'd you get this fish? The waiter might not know. He might just say, well, it came from the kitchen, right?
Yeah.
And so the aquarium's stance of going directly to the restaurants and making sure the restaurants have that information and that even the seafood providers have that information so that it's so much easier for the consumer. So as Phil said earlier, speaking with your wallet and making your decisions with your wallet, you know that by going to these specific restaurants that the aquarium's working with, you can feel better about the choices that you're making.
Yep, and most seafood is actually consumed at restaurants, even though they sell it at grocery stores. Most people in the United States consume their seafood when they go out to a restaurant.
I do.
Yeah, I love the fish choices.
I'm not very good at cooking it, so I'm going to go have somebody else cook it.
That's right.
So you can see the seafoodforthefuture.org website on the bottom, the address on the bottom. That's part of the aquarium, and it's a really cool initiative that we have to work with local restaurants. So check that out. So we're educating ourselves, we're learning about where our fish comes from, we're supporting marine protected areas and knowing where we are when we're in a marine protected area. Any other things that we can do? What about NOAA's website?
NOAA is a great resource, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric mm-hmm. Administration. Not a lot of people actually know about NOAA. They don't know about NOAA.
You should know what NOAA
is. Kind of like NASA. They're kind of like the NASA of the ocean. Mm-hmm. And so they are at the forefront. Their scientists are at the edge of what we know about the ocean, and that's their job all the time. So if you go to NOAA, you're going to get lots of resources. There are, you know, government initiatives that people are paid to go out and tell people about what we know about the ocean. There's something called Fish Watch mm-hmm. at NOAA, and that's another great resource that you can use for finding out what fish out there are good choices so that you can do your best. Nobody's perfect, but all we do is we do our best at trying to conserve these animals.
Right. So really educate yourself, make choices locally, mm-hmm. Learn a little bit more about not only what's good for you, but what's also good for the environment. So the one last thing that I would love to talk about, I put it away already. Let's talk about a little bit more about these abalone. So our mystery item today was abalone, and I have a number of different abalone shells here. There are a number of different species of abalone, but this was, Phil, can you tell us a little bit about sort of some of the plight of abalone? Why do we not see them so much in the ocean anymore?
Well, in the 60s and 70s, abalone became a very popular dish, especially here in Southern California. They are slow moving. They are near
this thing moves?
Yeah, they're snails, so they have a great flavor. They are delicious, they're really easy. They were easy for divers to swim down and get, and just, you know, take a knife, wedge it under, pull this off the rock, put it in a bag, and take it back. Unfortunately, abalones this size are fairly, this is a fairly adult size abalone. They start off, we have some at the aquarium that are, you know, spawned last year. They're only about this big. So these are really mature. It takes them a long time to grow. You can see the striations, the stripes in their shells that reflect years of growth that they've had. And so the big ones, like one Ali's going to show us, the biggest one ever caught, really take a long time.
So abalone, you know, were overfished, obviously really easy to find. They didn't swim away. So they were just fished to basically extinction. A lot of people still don't report seeing very many of these. There is now a moratorium on abalone fishing here in Southern California. There is a limited abalone season, I believe, in Mendocino County, which is in Northern California. And one thing that is, you know, we pointed out earlier, is that the inside is this beautiful shiny shell. So not only were they collected for food, but they also made great jewelry. They could be made for belt buckles. They're beautiful, beautiful shells. Here in Southern California, we have green and red abalones that we are starting to see again. But we also have an abalone, and this is a slightly different one you may have noticed. I believe this is the black or the white
abalone. Black, and then this is the white.
The black abalone. Black abalone is now a federally listed endangered species. So this is a really rare one to have. So we have all of these shells here. And again, these are sort of the adult size, but I want to give you a little bit of a comparison here. This is not a real abalone shell. It's just a piece of plastic. This is how big the largest recorded abalone, I believe the largest red abalone was. Now, how come we don't have a shell of it? Because it's not very common that we see those anymore. So again, we're sort of changing what we see as a big abalone. This is considered an adult, whereas this is the biggest one that was recorded. So you can still eat abalone. If you go to a restaurant, abalone might be an option on the menu. When you get them, they're going to be very, very little steaks. That's because all abalone in restaurants are now from farms. Doesn't make sense that you're going to collect them from the ocean. There's just not enough of them. So it's one of those examples of where a farm might be a good option. They're not in a natural environment. They're sort of done separately. So abalone, you know, is a great story of its progression from overfishing to now potentially being still a good source of seafood, but not because they're being collected.
Right. So we will find solutions to these big challenges in our ocean. I want to thank you guys for coming out today. Do we have any end of the, you know, the program announcements we need to make?
No, I don't think so. We just have a couple seconds left here. So again, I just want to thank you for joining us today. Kira will be back next week. We hope you have a wonderful Thanksgiving. Make sure you're starting to work on your research proposal, which is due November 30th at 11:55. Final exam will open December 3rd. And come see us at the aquarium. Thanks so much, guys.